Over the past several years, SpaceX has received a lot of well-deserved praise and acclamation for their strides in lowering rocket launch cost. Another organization, however, that isn't nearly as celebrated is India's space organization. For decades, ISRO has slowly but consistently been driving down the cost of missions, across the board including orbital missions, lunar missions, and even Martian missions. In this video, we're going to look at the efficiency of India's space program. We're also going to look at its relationship with private space companies, and how that could change in the future. Since day one, the spaceflight industry has been extremely competitive, with countries developing the most advanced technologies and pushing the boundaries of what humans are capable of. But one country that isn't often mentioned in the history of spaceflight is India. For decades, the Indian Space Agency has been quietly working away and achieving some incredible results. When India began their space program in 1969, they entered into a world dominated by America and the Soviet Union. In the States, people were living well and businesses were booming with the new advancements in technology. In India, the people had nothing, and with a controlling government, even food was hard to come by. It was a strange time to start a space program. Apollo 11 had just returned from the moon, and NASA were spending around $40 billion each year in today's money. India came onto the scene with a mere $1 billion. So in order to make any impact in the space community, they had to get smart. Since day one, India was focused on using their space program to improve aspects of their own country. Things like telephone communication and weather forecasts were almost non-existent at the time, and for a country that was based on agriculture, this was a big problem. So over the next decade, India began launching satellites to provide communications and important weather data to improve the farming industry. But how did they manage to do all of this on such a tight budget? The early days of India's space program were extremely humble. Rocket parts were often transported by bike and larger components like satellites were transported by bull carts. During this time, India's space program employed just 3,000 workers. To put this into perspective, NASA was employing around 200,000 workers during the Apollo program. Nowadays, the employee count between ISRO and NASA is much more similar, but the efficiencies in India's infrastructure can still be seen today. India's space program pays far less for its skilled workforce than any other space agency. The average aerospace engineer in India gets paid around $10,000, whereas in America, the same job would pay 8 times more. This massive difference in cost allows India to undercut other countries on the cost to manufacture each rocket. Although most of India's rockets are only designed to launch small payloads, in some cases, the cost for launching on an Indian rocket is 70% cheaper than other options. The PSLV is India's workhorse rocket and it has a surprisingly low launch cost of just $15 million. In 2017, it pulled off a mission that stunned space programs around the world, by launching an incredible 104 satellites into orbit. Up until this year, the PSLV actually held the record for deploying the most number of satellites into sun-synchronous orbit in a single launch. Aside from being an extremely reliable launch vehicle, the PSLV is also extremely cost-efficient. Each launch is estimated to cost between $18 and $28 million. We'll estimate on the higher side and call it $25 million per launch. The PSLV is capable of delivering 3,800 kilograms into low Earth orbit, meaning that it costs $6,579 per kilogram. To put that into perspective, NASA's upcoming SLS rocket is expected to be able to put 70 metric tons into orbit, but the price tag per launch is over $2 billion. This means that the cost per kilogram is $28,572, which is over 4 times the cost of PSLV. Now, PSLV isn't nearly as cost-efficient as the Falcon 9, which only costs $2,193 per kilogram, which is only about a third of the cost of PSLV. Despite the extra engineering required to pull this off, sharing the launch cost between so many people made the cost for each satellite company extremely cheap. But India's cheap workforce is only half of what makes their rockets so affordable. Instead of outsourcing rocket parts to foreign companies, India gets most of its materials from local companies. Although they might be able to find more advanced components elsewhere, keeping all of the parts in-house saves India up to 50% in overall costs. Utilizing the expertise of other companies is a common theme in spaceflight. Now that the technology required to get into orbit is much more obtainable, it has allowed private companies like SpaceX and Rocket Lab to make a massive impact in the spaceflight community. But this is one area that holds India back. Although it's not illegal for India's private companies to enter space, the laws and regulations make it almost impossible for private space ventures to be set up, until recently. A new space bill has been written to allow the private sector to develop their own rockets and satellites. Traditionally, ISRO have contracted private companies to design and manufacture their rockets and spacecraft. Now, private space companies can spend their own time and money in developing more advanced spacecraft for interplanetary missions. Although India has experience with this, their interplanetary missions in the past have been limited in terms of what they can discover. But this isn't a fault of India's space program, this is by choice. A common theme that runs through India's space program is high ambition paired with a low budget. India always wanted to go to the Moon and Mars, and they didn't let their small budget stop them. The Mars Orbiter mission, which launched in 2013, made India only the fourth space agency to successfully get to Mars, and they did it on their first attempt. They also did this on a shoestring budget of just $74 million, a fraction of what other space agencies typically spend. Apart from making their spacecraft small and simple, India likes to keep the overall duration of the mission as short as possible. NASA has multiple missions that have spanned decades and racked up enormous running costs. From the initial concept to the end of operation, India's missions are designed to only run for a few years. So although India's capabilities and achievements might not be on the same scale as NASA, their incredible ambition and clever cost efficiency has allowed them to become one of the world's key players in the space community. From their humble beginnings cycling rocket parts back and forth, to launching spacecraft to other planets, their ability to achieve so much with so little is an inspiring story which sums up the Indian spirit. In order to continue being one of the greatest space agencies in the world, India will need to hire the next generation of talented and creative engineers. Clearly, ISRO has made massive strides when it comes to reducing the cost of space missions, but they're just getting started. Looking forward, ISRO plans to launch Aditya L1 to the Sun in 2022, Shukrayaan 1 to Venus in 2023, and Mangalyaan 2 to Mars in 2024. They also have a mission to Jupiter planned, but we don't have the details of that mission yet. Looking forward though, the future of ISRO is looking especially bright as their budget continues to be increased year after year. ISRO's budget has tripled over just the last 10 years. This is in stark contrast to NASA, whose budget peaked 50 years ago. At the end of the day, ISRO is one of the most advanced space organizations in the world. They're not quite on the level of SpaceX when it comes to cost efficiency, but they're magnitudes ahead of other government-funded space programs. Considering this, it's just a matter of time until ISRO places humans in orbit and eventually on the Moon and Mars. Did you guys realize how cost-efficient ISRO was? Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.